Hi, Steven. One of the companies I really love is Xiaomi and its founder Lei Jun. And what he said is very much that he wants to beat Apple, beat Samsung. And last quarter, he actually beat Apple in terms of cell phone, smartphone sales. Do you think Apple will be able to keep up with this company?
Well, first of all, Pascal, Apple has never been the market leader with smartphones. They go for the profit. So they have about 14% of the market share, but they take 42% of the profits of the global market of smartphones. So that I think they're looking at ways to make money. But the challenge for Apple, of course, is to go to the extra mile in terms of innovation and developing new platforms. But I think Apple has those capabilities, and there's more than the smartphone, of course. They have all the services that are growing in importance. So I think it's going to be very cool to see how those two companies will be competing with each other. But I suggest we dive into the details.
In 2010, Lei Jun set up Xiaomi, and his goal, his dream, was to build a product as good as Apple's iPhones, but then to build that on Android. And that was really the intention for him. And so being an engineer and having seven other people that were really technical around him, they set up the company called Xiaomi just 11 years ago. And the first phone that came out just a year later in 2011 was the Mi 1. And it was really a phone that you wouldn't consider a very, very smart smartphone, but it was pretty well designed for the time being. Xiaomi in itself is called, actually Mi in Chinese means rice, and Xiaomi is called little rice or millet, and that's the grain that's used in the north of China. But for him, Mi had another meaning as well. For him, it was really about mobile internet. That's where the Mi comes from. So it's about rice because then you can do anything. You can give energy to the whole population, and that's what he wanted to do. But this mobile internet, and there's another saying like mission impossible with Mi, because for him, he was competing against Apple. I mean, competing against Apple, but in a market of China with 1.4 billion consumers, that is a challenge. Now, when he launched his Mi 1, and he did the same way of doing it as Steve Jobs did, the whole world was laughing at Lei Jun. I was saying like, I mean, this guy, it's a copycat, it's not serious, they're not going to do anything like Apple ever did. And this was in 2011. But then little by little, this company became better and better and more innovative, and that is really what makes their strength today. Now, one of the promises and secrets that he made back then was that any product that he would make would be at no more than 5% above, the price would not be at more than 5% than the cost, the total cost of building the product. And so the big value of buying a Xiaomi, even back then, 10 years ago, was really about getting almost an iPhone quality, but at a much, much lower price. And when you look at the Chinese market, of course, that took off. And this was a strategy that many companies had, but not Samsung, not Apple, no. They wanted to really focus on just having a little bit more than the cost. So how are they making money? How is Xiaomi making money if they're not making money from their smartphones? Well, they have a lot of other things. And so what they've built is an ecosystem. What that means is that they've built thousands of suppliers and hundreds of partners that are building products. They call them the IoT lifestyle products, products that you use every day, whether it's an air conditioner or it's a television or a voice speaker or whatever you can think of, a camera, smart camera. All these things are built by their partners. And then these partners also sell at only 5% on top of the cost. But it's making these devices connected and smart and providing these internet services through the smartphone of Xiaomi that is actually where they're making their money. They're actually making more than 60% of all the money on internet services. And that's because until these devices are connected and really become useful in your life, in your house, in your home, well, why would you pay more money for this phone? And that's a very different strategy than Apple, for example, had. Now, if you compare today the latest Xiaomi phones and the latest Apple phones, there's a lot of reviews you can find online. And usually it's like, Yeah, I don't know. Maybe one is better than the other for certain features, but they're getting very, very close one to the other. Whether it's the mid-end or the high-end, I mean, they're really, really getting to the quality. And that is because of Xiaomi's innovation skills. They're really good at innovating and going ahead of the market. Something that we got used from Apple, but Xiaomi is doing that very well too. Just last quarter, in Q2 2021, Xiaomi for the first time actually became the biggest smartphone manufacturer in the world on market share. They beat Apple, not Samsung yet, but that's their next goal in the next years. And so this is not a small company anymore. A company that sells more smartphones than Apple, I mean, is a company you should look at. But they're also going into many new directions. And one of their latest things is also just like Apple and Steven explained, it's going into the electrical vehicles or going into the cars. And Xiaomi will also be building a cars. But again, this is going to be built with partners. Now, the big difference is that they're not building a car because everybody's building a car. They're building a car because this is one of the products that is part of this internet environment, this IoT connected environment, this lifestyle environment that people also want to use on a daily basis. So it's just a product, whether it's an air conditioner or a car, for Xiaomi that doesn't matter as long as it's connected through the phones. Now, if we look at the opportunities, I mean, there's huge opportunities for this company. First of all, they're the number two in the world today in smartphone sales, but they're also bringing out really cool products. Think about the foldable phones, like double screen phones with liquid cameras. I mean, it's so advanced and so cool. And I have some friends in Beijing that already bought these phones, and they just say, you have to buy one. It's fantastic. Now, if you think about the IoT and lifestyle products, I mean, there's dozens, millions of products, I could say, that still could be connected. Every product that we use on a daily basis is starting to become smart. And so having this position of having this smartphone be the connector and controller of all these smart devices is a very good opportunity for the future. Because the factory of the world of smart devices is only one place, it's China. And Xiaomi has the relationships with all these partners. But they're also going into new businesses, not just cars, they're going into chip manufacturing, also because this is something the government is supporting, but it's something they also need to be more independent from the US, because you never know what will happen. Xiaomi in itself, and that's what I really like about them, is becoming what we call an adventure brand. And just like Red Bull, they want to show that they go to the extreme, to the limits of what people want. And this is something that I think Xiaomi, in their lifestyle thinking, can really achieve. Now, Xiaomi has a lot of challenges. And one of the biggest challenges, of course, is everything that's happening in the US and in the West when it comes to, for example, if you think about Huawei, they got banned from getting chips, from getting Android. They actually can't sell in the US. Imagine if Xiaomi would have the same issue as Huawei had, then of course they wouldn't stay the number two in the world. But as long as they can sell into these Western markets, which they can today, it's probably okay. But there's always that sort of Damocles ahead, above their heads, that they never know what is going to happen. And I don't think it's going to be a big issue because they're not into the infrastructure like Huawei is, but you never, never know. And so also like Google and privacy issues, that's something like Android could be banned. If they have that, they have a real issue because everything's built on Android. Of course, you can use the open source Android, but still it's not the same thing. And then I think one of the big challenges for Xiaomi is their brand recognition. Not that they're a bad brand. In China, everybody knows them. In many countries in the world, like India, they're very popular. But in many new markets, they have to start from scratch. I don't think there's anyone in the world that doesn't know what Apple is, but many people don't know yet what Xiaomi is. And so specifically when it comes to customer service, they still have an uphill battle because they don't have that whole infrastructure yet to help the customers in every country in the world. They're actually growing too fast to give the service that the customer needs. Now, if we think about the offer you can't refuse, and specifically the ultimate convenience part of it, I believe Xiaomi is at the same quality as Apple today. I mean, they're also inventing a lot of new things, they're innovating daily, and the quality difference is getting very, very slim. So I think on that size, it's really an opportunity for the consumers, specifically those that want it at a lower price, because that means people can buy a high quality phone at a lower price, and that is very convenient. But it's not just the phones. I mean, besides the phones, it's also all the lifestyle products around it. This has to do with, you could think about it as an Amazon hardware model, where anything you want to buy is available through Xiaomi, and everything is connected through Xiaomi, and they have more product categories than you can imagine. I mean, there's 2,000 categories that you can choose from today in China easily and still connect all of them. So your smart home is just a fact. And it's not just that it's lower price, all these products, it's that there's also a lot of price categories. That means if you want to buy cheaper products or more expensive products, they have all the range that you can think of. So for the customer, this is all about choice and price. And these things two combined is of course very convenient. Now, when we think about partner in life, and we think about Xiaomi, this is really two things. It's their customers and their users, and it's also their partners who are building these devices. And specifically when we think about the partners, and we think about all these companies that are building all these IoT devices in China, what you see is that they are getting often invested or vested from Xiaomi, so they have a vested interest to make these partners successful. And this is not just about making themselves successful, it's about making their partners successful. And so if you join the Xiaomi ecosystem as a new product designer company, then automatically you don't just get money, you get resources, you get integration, you get a market, you get customers' experience, you get reviews, you get everything that you need to make your startup successful. Now on the customer side, this is something Xiaomi has been doing very well for a long, long time. They've created this fan and loyalty-based environment, and that has to do with an engagement and an empowerment of the customer, the user, into their system. Very different from Apple, which usually try to predict the future. Xiaomi was actually listening very well to what their customers wanted and took all these ideas into their new phones, and that's why they have so many categories, specifically in the IoT. But these fans feel that they belong to Xiaomi, and so the loyalty to Xiaomi is very, very high, and we don't always think about that or know about it. Now, if we think about saving the world, saving the planet, I mean, we shouldn't forget, Xiaomi is like 11 years old. I mean, Apple was established in 1976, if I'm right, or 74. I mean, it's a long, long time ago. Xiaomi is just 11 years old. And if you see already what they're doing, specifically with plastic waste, they're very, very serious and conscious about how to improve that. But they're also made smart apps. Think about the earthquake app. So this is very useful for people who are living in an environment where there's earthquakes. The Xiaomi phone will really target to help them to make sure that they, if there's an earthquake notice that need to be done, that they know exactly on time and what to do and give them advice what their next steps should be. During the pandemic, we saw Xiaomi, just like many other Chinese companies, giving a lot to humanitarian contributions, specifically masks and other things, not just in China, worldwide. And so they were really helping. But this is just a young company. So they did more than you would expect for a company from 11 years old. And now with their electrical vehicles, it's very clear they really want to figure out how to save the planet, save the world, and in the meantime, also become very, very good and be the number one in the world, beat Samsung, that's their next goal, and the best smartphone manufacturer in the world with most applications and most devices that they can offer, and they just want everybody to love them.
Apple is one of those companies, of course, with a huge history. We all know that. One of the more fascinating things for me is that throughout the past decades, Apple is seen as the most innovative company in the world. They're the only one who keeps their number one position throughout all those years. And of course, the tipping point in the past 15 years was the launch of the iPhone that not just changed the way Apple was looked at, but it changed the entire world and how we lived. I still love the sentence that Steve Jobs used when he launched the iPhone, saying it's going to be our life in our pocket. And back in 2007, we didn't have a clue what he was talking about, but today we know it's a very accurate description of what it would be. And just to show you the power of the iPhone, I mean, there's still a rumor out there that Apple will invest in cars. And one of the questions my oldest son had, he was like, "Dad, imagine that Apple will build a car. Will it still have windows?" I love that quote.
But it's a rumor, but more and more you feel that it might actually happen one day. But just to for the sake of the hypothesis, imagine that Apple would bring a car to market and it would be as successful as BMW. Even then, the value and the revenue and the profit of the iPhone would be higher than the revenue of the Apple car, just to show you how powerful this one product is. And this is not just the iPhone. It's not a one-trick pony. Like, take the AirPods. I love using them. They have a revenue of $12 billion. If you compare that with a number of other tech companies, it's crazy to see that actually the revenue of the AirPods is higher than the entire revenue of Adobe. And it's almost as high as the entire revenue of Uber, just to show you how strong each of these individual products are. Now, one of the growth areas for Apple is the services to go beyond products. And in the last couple of years, this had a tremendous growth. It more than doubled in the past couple of years. And this is going to increase in importance even more for the future of Apple. And it's all part of that ecosystem. I think that most people who use Apple have multiple devices, because once you're in the ecosystem, it works so well that you don't want to get out of that. And even though they're so successful, the most successful company in the world, the most valued companies in the world, they still have quite some challenges ahead of them. Of course, we have the hardware shortage today. We have antitrust matters that could happen. But in terms of strategy, I think there's some interesting things happening that could become a challenge for Apple. Take Apple TV, for instance. It's a streaming platform. But if you compare it with Netflix, I mean, they're nowhere. I would have assumed that a couple of years ago they would have acquired Netflix with all that cash that they have on the bank, but they didn't do that. And Netflix still dominates the market. Even though Apple has such an important ecosystem, Netflix is still dominating that market. And one of the challenges that Apple has is that some of the models that they grew on in the past couple of years could be turned upside down by the market. Like, take iTunes. iTunes was new, disruptive, innovative in the music industry. They were extremely successful, but then suddenly Spotify came and streaming came along, and Apple suddenly had to catch up. That was new for them. And the innovation happened so rapidly that they weren't the market leader in that. Take Apple TV. In the past, with Apple TV, Apple believed that they could build the tracks without owning the trains, which means that these guys had to dream of delivering the ecosystem, delivering the platform, and the content had to be delivered by others, the trains. Now they're completely changing that strategy. And with Apple TV Plus, they decided to invest billions in creating their own content, building their own studios, setting up partnerships with Hollywood to make sure that they have exclusive content. And this is the item that is being used in the streaming wars between Amazon, Apple, and Netflix, the quality and the exclusivity of the content. So Apple now is building the tracks and the trains at the same time, which is completely new for them. And of course, maybe the biggest challenge for Apple is, like, what is life after the iPhone? Today, the iPhone is still growing. It's almost impossible to believe, but it's still growing in importance for the company. But one day, sooner or later, I mean, we're going to have a new platform. And one of the items that Apple is really going for is the platform of augmented reality. They believe that that will be the next computer platform where we'll no longer holding our phones, but maybe we'll be using glasses, maybe we'll be using other devices, but that we get an additional digital layer in the world from our point of view in every move that we make. Question is, will Apple be the leader in that market again? And this is probably their biggest challenge. Now, if you look to the offer you can't refuse, if you look at how well they are performing in customer experience, I always work with this model with four layers. If you want to be successful in today's world, of course you need good products, price, and service. You need digital convenience. But more and more, customers expect you to become a partner in life with broader services. And people expect you to add value to society. Four layers that bring value to the customer. And if you bring those together in one storyline, you're actually bringing an offer people can't refuse. Now, in many of these elements, many of these dimensions, Apple actually invented the whole system. I take digital convenience. I love this quote of Steve Jobs, where he's like, guys, if you develop something, start with the customer experience, work backwards. And they delivered that. I don't know if you've ever thought about it in this way, but basically the iPhone was the first technological product, truly innovative product, that came to the market without a manual or without a help desk. It just worked. And since that moment in time, every time that you and me, we buy something, we expect it to work without having to read a 100-page manual. And the whole unboxing experience that comes with it and that experience that they create is absolutely something that they invented. And because of them, we think it's the most normal thing in the world. And then you have partner in life. If you look at what the iPhone did, it actually achieved its goal. It became our life in our pocket. And it's not just a phone, it's our wallet, it's our healthcare partner, it's our mobility partner. Our phone basically brings value to every aspect in our life, and Apple is at the heart of that ecosystem. But there's more than just a phone. Look at the Apple stores, still the most successful retail concept in the world. But they're not just selling in those stores. They're trying to increase the overall awareness and the overall knowledge about digital tools. They have their Genius Bar, and you can just walk in and learn from their teams how everything works and how you can upgrade your skills in terms of digital. So they want to become a partner, not just in delivering the products, but they want to become a partner in our digital knowledge from a broad point of view. And then you have the top of the model, changing your world. We could talk about sustainability here, but I want to talk to one of the elements that is that Apple is using to differentiate itself, and that's the element of ethics and privacy. Apple really believes that privacy is a value that is being underestimated in the world, and they want to bring that back to the customer. They believe that privacy is a fundamental human right, and that if you believe in privacy and if you believe that that's important, that you need to get an iPhone. And they even go into conflicts with the government about this, but they stand ground and they want to protect our data, they want to protect our privacy. That's what they stand for. And I like this because this is an example of adding value to society by using your core strengths. They look at their core strengths and they leverage, and it helps society, it increases the ethics and privacy, and it also at the same time brings value to the customer because they facilitate us in having a safer and better life. So in my opinion, Apple is one of those examples that really brings an offer you can't refuse to the market. Their products are fantastic. The convenience levels are very high. They are, and everyone who's using Apple, they can acknowledge that it is a partner in our life. And they add value to society in a way that it links back to their brand and their core strength.
So Pascal, when I hear your story, for me, it becomes clear that Xiaomi is really focusing on product development, feature development. I was wondering, isn't that a challenge? Because, I mean, the brand recognition, brand power, awareness, I think is still pretty low. If you compare that with Apple, where you have some sort of a brand religion, where people are actually willing to pay a lot of money for the same quality, as you mentioned, it shows the power of that brand. And I think that's going to be a really tough one to catch up with for Xiaomi.
No, definitely. I think the brand awareness that Apple has is something that Xiaomi still needs to build, specifically outside China. In China, it's less of a problem. Okay. But I do believe people are going to be willing to pay a higher price for the connectivity, because it's not just about the phone anymore, it's about your whole life. And I think that's where Xiaomi could really make a difference. And in my view, it could become like a fashion item.
Like glasses, for instance.
Exactly. And you just buy them when you want them on a Tuesday, for example.
Yeah. Well, I think it's an interesting philosophy to think about. What if the iPhone becomes like, or the phone, sorry, the phone becomes like an accessoire and you get a new one every week? I'm not sure if that will happen, but it's a very interesting way of looking at it. But it's, we'll see what the future brings. So guys, thanks for watching. We hope you enjoyed our insights on Xiaomi and Apple, and see you again in the next video.
And if you haven't subscribed yet, do so now, and see you next week.